Father, we do give you thanks for your grace among us, that you are working in powerful ways. Holy Spirit, we pray that you open our hearts, that we might be faithful as we worship you, not being distracted by many things, but bringing them to your throne, eager to hear from you, eager to walk with you. God, yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever, and so we rightly worship you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and sing Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. My Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. From above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
My chains are
Father, we do give you such great praise, such great thanksgiving. I know me, myself, and I need a flood of mercy. Not just a drop, but a flood. And dear Lord, you give it without measure, without holding back. You give it. Holy Spirit, we now welcome you in this place to sweep across our hearts, to open our hearts by your wind that blows out all the cobwebs. Sweep through with that flood, those rivers of grace. That Holy Spirit, we might hear you this morning and make real changes. We are your people. We now open ourselves up to you, Father. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. I'm going to invite a prayer team member up to lead us in prayer. And I'll turn your attention to the prayer list as they come up. Esther, you can come on up. I want to go ahead and encourage us for something before Esther leads us in prayer. You've got your prayer needs listed in the bulletin. And I also want us to close our bulletin for a moment and turn to the back, the very back. And you'll see on the bottom under church office, there's some new words there. Text thread. I sent a text out this morning. The Psalm 122 says, man, I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. If you did not get that text, I need to ask you a favor. I need you to look at those instructions right there for text thread. And text hi to that phone number right there. And it'll set you right up in the system. You'll start getting the text thread that goes out. You can also scan that QR code and it'll put you in on the text thread as well. But if you did not get the text, I want to make sure everybody is in there. First, it'll say, hey, what's your name? And they'll say, oh, that's great. Now, what's your email? And then you'll be fully in there to get the text. That's also a great way to send in a prayer request. Now, if you ever think that you're texting me and you get an automatic response, that means you accidentally text the thread and not me. My number has not changed. That's not my cell phone number. That's the church's text thread. But you can always send in prayer requests really easily into that thread, and we can capture them there. And sometimes you'll see me jump on and say, hey, this is Pastor Tim. I just want you to know we got that text for the prayer need. Good. Esther, can you lead us in prayer?
Let's start with silent prayer. Father, we come to you in these moments. Help us, Lord, to fix our eyes on Jesus. Thank you for the promise that you hear us when we pray. We lift up the ones on our list. In particular, I pray for Don Glover, that surgery would go smoothly. And I pray for each one that is on our list. We ask that you bring your presence into their situations, their needs, their pain. We ask that you would heal their bodies, heal their hearts. Help them to trust you and grow in their faith through these situations. Help us to be your hands and feet, to minister to them as you lead us. Give them peace and grace to lean on you when it is hard. We pray that you would bless Pastor Tim and the church leaders. Help them as they guide us. I pray for increased unity and fruit in our church ministries, specifically the small groups and the band groups. I pray that you would guide us with JAM. And Lord, I pray for the missionaries, that you would open doors for their ministries, for gospel conversations, for the lost to come to faith, for good fruit that lasts, for revival in those nations as well as in ours. In particular, I pray for Sarah Oglesby on her trip, that you would guide each of her steps. We pray for the government leaders of all of the nations around the world to humble themselves before you. Help us to be your people, salt and light in our communities. And now we pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Would the ushers and a lay leader come up? And as they do, I want to point our attention to the disciple bands on the inside. Again, our missions moment for today, just like it has been since the turn of the year, is focused on a discipleship theme. Our mission as a church is to be disciples and make disciples. And for the past 6 weeks of the new year, we've been focusing on the first part of that, being disciples. The disciple bands is a very, very important tool for going deeper in our faith. If you've never experienced it, then you don't quite know how valuable it can be to your faith. It's different than a small group. It's different than a Bible study. It's different than a Sunday school. This is something that the vast majority of contemporary American Christians have not actually ever experienced. And I want to give us an opportunity to explore it. Not make a big, large commitment to it, but explore it during Lent. Lent is 6 weeks long. Tonight at 5 p.m., I'm going to do an information meeting, a gathering, a launching even of some bands, 2 to 4 people. They're very small, tight-knit groups. I encourage you to come tonight, 5 p.m., figure out what it's about, these band meetings, banding together, just for 6 weeks. Just for 6 weeks. Try it out during Lent. And I promise if you stick with it, you will say what I say now. I've been with my band for 2.5 years now, and I've said it probably every week since the turn of the year, but it is one of the absolute most powerful things in my spiritual walk with God, and I just encourage you to take hold of that opportunity while it's there. Waldo, can you lead us in prayer?
Dear God, we just thank you for these many blessings that you've given us. We especially ask you to be with us as we give our tithes and offerings this morning. Take these tithes and offerings and just make them work for your kingdom, and just help us to do the things that you would want us to do. Thank you for the rain. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. We sang this song many weeks ago, and oh good. Look, Ronnie's already always 2 steps ahead of me. He's got it up there. Such a beautiful song, and it fits pretty well with today's scripture. I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. From the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness to glorious my place, laid aside the tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. And thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness to glorious light. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness to glorious light. Brought me from the darkness to glorious light. Glory to His name. Glory to His wonderful name. There at the cross where my Savior died. Glory to His name. There at the cross where my Savior died. There where for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His wonderful name. There at the cross where my Savior died. Glory to His name. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness to glorious light. Amen. Amen. Well, kids, if you would like to go with Miss Janet, third grade and younger, if you'd like to, you don't have to, but she's back there for Children's Church. Go ahead, but go ahead.
Good morning. We'll be reading Hebrews 12, 1 through 3, and James 5, 14 through 16. Therefore, since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let's rid ourselves of every obstacle and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let's run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking only at Jesus, the originator and perfecter of the faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who has endured such hostility by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. James 5, 14 through 16. Is anyone among you sick? Then he must call for the elders of the church, and they are to pray over him, anointing him with the oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith will restore the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, they will be forgiven him. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. A prayer of a righteous person, when it is brought about, can accomplish much.
Come on. Oh, you're okay. Here you go. Here, let's take your jacket. Perfect. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Pam. Thank you, Winfields. Hey, a couple notes before we jump into the sermon. Sharon did a fantastic job setting the altar for what's called Transfiguration Sunday. And the sermon's not about Transfiguration Sunday, so I want to take a few moments briefly to talk about Transfiguration Sunday. It happens to fall on this time of the year. It's getting close to the cross and Jesus' story, but not quite there. We might recall the story where Jesus took James and John up on the mountain, and in their presence, they saw that Jesus was in fact the Son of God. Jesus was exalted with Moses at one hand, Elijah on the other, and God the Father named Jesus as his son right there in their sight. And so I love the way that Sharon decorated in white. That was definitely a white celebration, worship-filled moment. But also, the cross is veiled. What a beautiful picture, I think, veiled by this white. They're not quite to the cross yet, and the full glory of Christ was not actually revealed yet, because he had not yet gone through the cross, had not yet gone through the resurrection and the ascension. And so there's still more to the story yet to come. And part of that more to the story, Steve actually just read for us the beginning of Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, part of that more to the story is that heaven on earth, somehow the two have become invaded a bit in this thing called the church that Jesus gave birth to. That even though the entirety of God's kingdom has not yet arrived, we already experience tastes of God's kingdom here on earth, just like in the Transfiguration. We are surrounded, even in these moments, by a great cloud of witnesses. We are surrounded, even in these moments, by the church triumphant. And the writer of Hebrews says, therefore, let's run the race together. Let's chase after the prize together. Well, friends, we are in the second sermon of a short sermon series. Next week, we start Lent. I am excited about our Lent series. It's called Watch and Pray. We'll start that next week. But today we have the last sermon of bringing the band back together, the biblical practice of spiritual friendships. I'm going to start by reading from Genesis. Now, part of the ideas behind the sermon actually came from something I read from this book. This is our Lent book. I'm going to start teaching this study next week. If you don't yet have a Lent book, make sure you grab one before you leave. They're $15 a piece. I'll be teaching that on Sunday evenings at 4:30 and then Tuesday mornings 10:30. I'm going to make an attempt to record that as well. And if you're somebody who's like, I would even tune in on Zoom, let me know. I might try to figure that one out. But I'm going to teach it in person, 4:30 on Sunday and 10:30 on Tuesday morning. The point being, I want as many people as possible to participate in this Lent study. I think the conversations about the cross and the blood of Christ are going to be so rich along the way these next 6 weeks. But before we get there, I'm going to start by reading from Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. Verses 1 through 13. Hear the word of God. Now the serpent was more cunning than any animal of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God really said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? The woman said to the serpent, From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may not eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die. The serpent said to the woman, you certainly will not die. For God knows that on the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you'll become like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took some of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves waist coverings. Now they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? And he said, well, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself. And God said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree from which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me some of the fruit of the tree, and I ate. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this that you've done? And the woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. About 40% of the population, which if you do quick math, is 4 out of every 10 people. 4 out of every 10 people share this most common fear. Can you guess what it is? This most common fear. Any guesses out there? Snakes? No. Snakes are high on the list. Spiders are like number 3. Spiders are pretty high. Yeah, you said boo to spiders. Yeah. Any other guess? Tarantula. Spiders are up there, Wyatt. You've got them. There are many people with you, buddy. They don't like spiders. It's not spiders, though. It's not. What's that? Darkness? That's a good one. But no, that one's not it. That's a good one, though, Amos. Heights? Scared of heights is also high on the list. Second is a fear of death, but notice even the fear of death is not number one. The most common fear is public speaking. I assure you that's what the research shows. 4 out of every 10 people are deathly afraid of public speaking, and researchers have even pinned down a why behind this fear of public speaking. One, they don't want people to look at them. All eyes are on you when you're the public speaker. Two, afraid of forgetting words, stumbling over words, not saying things right, and so it comes out all jumbled. Number three, self-comparison with other speakers. Well, I'll never be as good as that speaker. Why should I even try? That's one reason. Number four, afraid of being judged. Everybody's watching you, paying attention to your ideas, how you present yourself. Fear of public speaking. You know, if I summed it up, that whole list, there was more that I could have read, but if I summed up that whole list of why people are afraid of this thing called public speaking, I think I might put it into one idea. We are afraid of being exposed. We're afraid of being exposed as a fraud, exposed as inexperienced, exposed for our weakness, exposed for our lack, exposed, we are afraid of other people seeing us. We're afraid of being placed on the spot, we might say. I mean, after all, the spot has a light on it. The spot just might shine a light on what we'd rather stay hidden. And you know, it's fascinating to me, not just the research of 4 out of every 10, but it's fascinating to me how far-reaching this is, this fear is, into even our hearts. Has anyone else ever had that strange dream where we show up to school, work, some public place and suddenly realize that somehow we forgot half our clothes. Anybody ever had that dream? Yes. A fear of being exposed, of being laid bare, of being seen for who we really are. And if we took these ideas and we put them into biblical language, the biblical language we would use is one word: shame. Shame. It's not a word we use very often. We kind of dodge that word shame, but that's really what that idea is. We're ashamed of something being exposed. I think this is a deep, deep shared family root that we all have. A family root that actually goes back to that story of Adam and Eve in the garden. You think about what we just read. Just after the fall of humanity into sin, what do Adam and Eve do? Well, they feel shame for the very first time in human existence. They eat the fruit, the knowledge of good and evil, and suddenly they realize they're naked in a public place. Our worst nightmare. But to me, this is a great irony of this garden moment. They fashion clothes made of fig leaves and hide from who? From each other. Public place. Husband and wife. That's the only one in the garden. They're hiding from each other. And here we see sin rearing its ugly head. They're ashamed of being exposed, even with their spouse. Even husbands and wives now have something that they keep hidden. Some kind of distance between the two. Some kind of areas of shame that stays veiled behind our fig leaves. And we don't use this word shame all the time. We really don't. We try to avoid it, in fact. But still, I'm talking about something that we wouldn't just expose even to our spouse out in the open. In other words, we're often ashamed of someone else seeing the truth. Which means that that dream of being found naked, the fear of being exposed by the spotlight, these are all symptoms of the fall. These are all symptoms of a deep-seated family inheritance, the shame of sin found in every single human being. I want to spend some time today exploring how the Bible talks about this problem of shame and end with how the gospel gives a beautiful reply to this universal problem of shame. The text from Genesis in the fall, the Genesis 3 text, I think it gives us a solid foundation, but going along with last week's theme, I want to stick with the story of King David. In fact, I want to read today a rather obscure part of David's story. It's not really obscure. In fact, it's right after the story of David and Bathsheba, one of the most read stories of David's life. It's right after it. It's not really obscure. And yet, it's a story of shame. A story of hiding away, sweeping under the rug what David didn't want to come out into the public eye. And just like last week's story, I find this passage of Scripture one of Mighty David's greatest falls. It's from 2 Samuel chapter 13. So if you've got a Bible, would you turn there with me? 2 Samuel chapter 13. I want to start by reading the first two verses of this. Let's pray before we read. Father, we give you thanks for your words. I do pray once again, Holy Spirit, you come open our hearts. Let us hear your words. Holy Spirit, come speak to us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. 2 Samuel chapter 13, starting in verse 1. Now it was after this, once again, after David, Bathsheba, that whole stuff settles. It was after this that Absalom, the son of David, had a beautiful sister whose name was Tamar. And Amnon, the son of David, was in love with her. But Amnon was so frustrated on account of his sister Tamar that he made himself ill, for she was a virgin. And it seemed too difficult to Amnon to do anything to her. Just reading that, anybody else already have ick feelings? Ick feelings, just gross right from the start. We meet three different characters, Absalom, Tamar, Amnon. All three are children of David. Absalom and Tamar, they share the same mother, and their half-brother Amnon shares the same father. Which means, verse 2 is telling us that Amnon is lusting after his half-sister Tamar so intensely that he has literally made himself sick. Friends, we're dealing with sin right from the opening punches of chapter 13. In fact, we're dealing with some pretty grotesque sin from the opening punches. And in Amnon's sin sickness, he begins to seek out an equally sick friend. Let's keep reading in verse 3. But Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimeah, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very clever man. And he said to him, "Why are you, the king's son, so depressed morning after morning? Will you not tell me?" So Amnon said to him, "I am in love with Tamar, the sister of my brother Absalom." Jonadab then said to him, "Lie down on your bed and pretend to be ill. When your father comes to see you, say to him, 'Please have my sister Tamar come and give me food to eat, and have her prepare the food in my sight, so that I may see it and eat from her hand.'" Jonadab is by far the opposite of good company to keep around. You know, last week's conversation, we talked about how friends can be a powerful force, either for godly pursuits or for the opposite. Jonadab is for the opposite. But you know, even worse than just having a bad friend around, verse 3 tells us Jonadab is David's brother. What a twisted family they have, right? A wild web we weave. An uncle of Absalom, Tamar, and Amnon. And this uncle advises Amnon to deceive his sister Tamar, to act like he's sick and call on her to serve him alone, to trick her, close the door, attack her. And Amnon thinks this is a great plan. We are falling deeper and deeper into sin. Verse 6 now. So Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill. When the king came to see him, Amnon said to the king, "Please have my sister Tamar come and make me a couple of pastries in my sight, so that I may eat from her hand." Then David sent a messenger to the house for Tamar, saying, "Go now to your brother Amnon's house and prepare food for him." So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was lying in bed. And she took dough, kneaded it, made pastries in his sight, and baked the pastries. Then she took the tray and served them to him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, "Have everyone leave me." So everyone left him. Then Amnon said to Tamar, "Bring the food into the bedroom so that I may eat from your hand." So Tamar took the pastries which she had made and brought them into the bedroom to her brother Amnon. When she brought them to him to eat, he took hold of her and said to her, "Come sleep with me, my sister." But she said to him, "No, my brother, do not violate me, For such a thing is not done in Israel. Do not do this disgraceful sin. As for me, where could I get rid of my shame? And as for you, you will be like one of the fools in Israel. Now then, please speak to the king, for he will not withhold me from you. However, he would not listen to her. Since he was stronger than she, he violated her and slept with her. You know, there's just no way to hide or dodge what happens here. Painful language, especially if we ourselves have been a victim of this type of sexual violence. Amnon rapes Tamar. Verse 14 says he violates her and sleeps with her. And we like to dodge this. We like to hide from this. We like to not say this out loud. Except here's the problem. Tamar needs healing. Tamar is now full of shame. And there are certain kinds of pain that only find healing when someone outside of ourselves walks with us through the wounds. But in this story, no one walks with Tamar. No one stands for the victim. Instead, they isolate, shame, act like it didn't happen. They make Tamar deal with the trauma all on her own. Let's read some more, verse 15. Then Amnon hated her with a great hatred. Indeed, the hatred with which he hated her was greater than the love with which he had loved her. And Amnon said to her, "Get up, go away." But she said to him, "No, because this wrong in sending me away is greater than the other that you have done to me." Yet he would not listen to her. Then he called his young man who had attended him and said, "Now throw this woman out of my presence and lock the door behind her." Now she had on a long-sleeved garment, for this is how the virgin daughters of the king dressed themselves in robes. Then his attendant took her out and locked the door behind her. Tamar took ashes and put them on her head and tore her long-sleeved garment, which was on her. And she put her hand on her head and went on her way, crying out as she went. No one should ever have to be a Tamar. No one should ever have to deal with that kind of grief on your own. If you're in this room this morning and you've walked through that kind of grief on your own, that was not ever God's intention. And yet in this broken world after the fall that we live in, this is far too common an experience. People walking through shameful pain on their own. Tamar even cries out to Amnon about the second painful wrong, points out that leaving her alone to deal with the pain is even worse than the first pain on its own. And she's right. Because as horrible as the first offense is, the pain lingers, becomes far spread, even becomes deeper seated when a person has nowhere to turn for healing. Tamar's question in verse 13, it just echoes in the air. "Where could I get rid of my shame?" she asks. But Amnon slams and locks the door in her face. Treats her shame like a disgusting blight, a sickness that he hates, even though he himself caused it. And Absalom, Tamar's full-blooded sister, Absalom hardly does any better. Look at verse 20 this time. Then Absalom, her brother, said to her, "Has Amnon, your brother, been with you? But now keep silent, my sister. He is your brother. Do not take this matter to heart." So Tamar remained and was isolated in her brother Absalom's house. Don't take this matter to heart. How ridiculous of a thing for Absalom to say. Absalom tries to sweep the whole thing under the rug. Even has the audacity to command Tamar into silence. Worse still, the text says he isolates her in his own house. Absalom doesn't walk with Tamar at all. He just makes the shame even worse. Acts like Tamar is some wounded, broken, shameful vessel, no longer fit for the public eye. Tamar's question once again echoes, where can I get rid of my shame? And we think King David might do something about it at this point. The upright, God-fearing king, the father of these wayward children. We think he'd have something to say that brings healing. But to me, here sits David's second greatest fall. Look at verse 21. Now, when King David heard about all these matters, he became very angry. That's all the text says about what David does. David is angry, but he says nothing, does nothing to Amnon. David is angry, but he says nothing, offers no healing to Tamar. David is angry, but what good is anger towards sin if we need healing for our shame? See, I might be angry at sin in my life, but if I have no way of dealing with the shame, the sin only lingers. It stays locked in the closet for no one to see. Skeletons there in the closet. If I have nowhere to confess my sin, like James says in that passage we read earlier, if I have no one to walk with me, shame, it just begins to pull us further and further away from the light and into the darkness. If you keep reading in 2 Samuel here, it's an absolute train wreck from here on. The silence against Tamar, lack of justice for Amnon, it festers into murder, deception, and even open revolt against King David. But such is the way of sin and death and guilt and shame. It's a virus that just keeps spreading and spreading, pulling the sin sick further and further down into death. And poor Tamar, poor Tamar, silenced, as if it's her shame to bear. The victim wounded by the weight of another person's sin. Where can I get rid of my shame, she asks. And her question, it echoes in the air, I think, for two reasons. Now, for one, we ourselves feel helpless to sin, trapped in its pattern. Some of us have wrestled with one or two sin patterns for years without ever finding victory. So for one, we feel ourselves like victims who can't possibly pull ourselves up from the pit. We are Tamar in some ways, wounded by something outside our power to control, hiding our secret shame in the closet so no one sees the skeletons. No one sees how broken we really are inside. But also, Tamar's question echoes for a second reason also. I think it echoes because we know it actually is our shame to bear. Why else would we have a fear of opening the door? Why else would we have a fear of being exposed? Why else would we hold back those deeper layers of self from the prying eyes of friends, family, and sometimes even our spouse? We are ashamed of what might be seen, of what they might think. We're ashamed of the shame inside. And it's our shame, our sin we're talking about. We cringe to say it out loud, but we're not innocent. Where can I get rid of my shame? You know, we celebrate often the forgiveness of God given to us at the cross. And that is so right and good. We celebrate how the blood of Christ washes our guilt away. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Gives us that fresh start, makes us right with God again. But there's two things, main things, that the cross does, among many others. Washes away guilt and washes away shame. However, I have found many, many Christians who claim the first but are still paralyzed by the second, who know their forgiveness before God, that guilt is washed away, but they still live paralyzed by shame. For example, we want to be better in prayer, but so often lose our words when we sit down before a holy God. Because after all, the holy God sees every secret. The holy God knows everything about us. We stumble on our words, don't even know how to start, where to start, if we can even start, if God even forgives us, and we get paralyzed growing any further in our faith. And that's just one example of how many of us still cling to shame. You see, it's what happened to Adam and Eve in the garden. One moment, they're in the garden walking hand in hand with God during the evening breeze. And the next, they're crouching behind a fig tree as if the leaves made by the Creator are going to hide the eyes of the Lord Himself. But then again, we're afraid of the spotlight. Afraid of being exposed. Afraid of being publicly shamed. Afraid of being seen naked for who we really are. Where can I get rid of my shame? Because it can't be punished away. You keep reading in 2 Samuel, you'll find Absalom thought he could kill Amnon and solve the shame. That doesn't heal Tamar's shame. She's still hurting. Shame cannot be punished away. Shame can't be hidden away. That's what they tried to do with Tamar, isolate her, stuff it away in the closet. No, that just makes shame worse still. And the thing about shame is it can't even be defeated the same way death is. We can defeat death with a resurrection. What do you do for shame? There's only one way to heal shame. It's by sharing it. By sharing it. When someone shares the disgrace of our shame, well, we're no longer isolated, are we? Finally, we have at least one other person who names our worth as deeper than the shame. The shame leaves, vanishes when we have that one person who walks with us through it. And so, friends, it's no coincidence that Jesus dies on the cross naked. I know we may have never noticed that, but it's very clear in Matthew 27. The soldiers took Jesus' clothes, cast lots for his clothes. Jesus died on the cross naked, and that's not a coincidence for the things I'm talking about. It was common in that day to publicly disgrace, publicly shame, crucifixion, victims by stripping them bare, exposing them to the world. But get this, the book of Romans talks about salvation as being clothed with Christ. You ever read that? Being clothed with Christ. I love how Hebrews says it as well. Hebrews says in that passage we read that it was for the joy of salvation set before him that Jesus endured the shame of the cross. And then chapter 4 encourages us. Therefore, since we have Jesus as our great high priest, let us boldly approach the throne of God's mercy with confidence that God has embraced us with mercy. Woo! Shame has lost its power for those who are in Christ Jesus. That is the gospel. My Jesus bore my shame. That is the gospel. My Jesus healed my hidden pain. That is the gospel. No matter what the world may say of me, no matter what the world may think of me, Jesus saw my sin and died for me anyway. Jesus now looks at me and he doesn't say, "You're shameful and worth being isolated." Jesus looks at me and says, "Forgiven." He looks at me and says, "Washed in the power of the blood." He says, "You are a child of God, not because you cleaned yourself up before you came to this cross, but because I died for you while you were still a sinner." That is the gospel, friends. There's something beautiful here we so often miss. It's not a coincidence. God has opened wide the door for sin to be exposed. And that's not actually something to fear. In fact, it's actually gospel. It's actually good news. Because when we finally open that hidden door and let God deal with all the skeletons that fall out, well, who knows? Maybe we'll find resurrection on the other side. See, the gospel says that Christ has already long known about the sin anyway. That Christ has already long since paid the consequence of the sin and shame anyway. And that Christ has already said we can be God's child anyway. If we only repent and believe in the gospel, stop walking in the darkness, and turn instead to the light of Christ. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, I want to invite us to respond as we sing this last song together, but I also want to invite us to respond tonight. Part of the purpose of a band meeting is to fulfill the promise in James chapter 5 that Steve read for us at the beginning. Part of the purpose of the band meeting is to walk in that light, to find friends that we can walk with in this kind of way. James says, confess your sins to one another and you will be healed. I believe it because I've lived through it. I've lived through it. It is true. And so part of our response today is twofold. I encourage you, for one, let us bring our pains and our shame fully to the throne of God, to the cross. Let Christ heal it. Do that personal, individual, personal work inside with God. But as human beings, as biblical worldview teaches us, we're not just individuals who are isolated. We are part of a community. Let's do that second work too. That second work of banding together with people who can walk with us along the way. Hey, let's stand together and sing this last song, Jesus Paid It All.
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. Whole to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow." One more verse together.
Lord, now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Friends, we are called to be disciples and make disciples of Jesus Christ, who are Christ-led, Bible-based, Spirit-filled, and mission-driven. Let's go from this place walking in the freedom God gives us, even from shame. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.